Thank you. Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio questions is wellbeing economy, fair work and energy. I would remind members that if they wish to request a supplementary question, they should press their request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function online during the relevant question. And at question number one, I call Jeremy Balfour, who is joining us remotely. Mr. Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how the work of the City Centre Recovery Task Force is helping to increase footfall in shops.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I send my best wishes to Jeremy Balfour on his ongoing recovery. Delivery of actions in the Task Force's report is led by the Scottish Cities Alliance, of which the Scottish Government is a member. Last month, the First Minister and I met city leaders to hear about their ambitions. We have allocated £6 million from the City Centre Recovery Fund to take forward Task Force priorities. For example, part of Edinburgh's award facilitated the opening of the St James Quarter, including support for a retail and hospitality academy. Glasgow used some of its allocation to support the Golden Z regeneration project, focusing on the city centre's traditional shopping streets.
Jeremy Balfour.
Will the Cabinet Secretary follow the example of the UK Government and now support 75 business wage relief?
Cabinet Secretary.
Obviously, decisions around business rates are for the budget, and we are taking all aspects into consideration. However, obviously, part of that consideration is also the fact that just £10.8 million came as Barnett consequentials for the health service and therefore public services from the autumn statement. And obviously, we want to make sure that we are reflecting the needs of public services as well as supporting businesses at a very challenging time.
And supplementary, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Reinvigorating high streets is a Scotland-wide challenge, and our Union Street in Aberdeen has harnessed the ideas of Aberdonians to help transform the city centre for the better. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on the Scottish Government's support worth £400,000 to fund this campaign and give the iconic Union Street a fresh lease of life?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank Jackie Dunbar for that question. We've spoken with the Council and our Union Street to get more details on their plans. We want our investment to support the campaign to revitalise Union Street to be at its best effect. The Minister for Local Government, Empowerment and Planning visited Union Street in November to find out more about the initiative, and I think that a lot can be learned from this partnership, which involves business and the community, and provide further update as we have it.
Question number two, Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what value it places on the role of trade unions in delivering and sustaining a wellbeing economy.
Cabinet Secretary.
A critical high value. Trade unions are key social partners in realising our fair work ambitions as we successfully transition to a net zero economy. This forms the foundation of a wellbeing economy, one that creates better communities, capitalises on the opportunities of net zero to establish a fair, green and growing economy. Our strategic relationship with the STUC is underpinned by a memorandum of understanding which demonstrates the value of trade union input to the Scottish Government through commitments to include the STUC in relevant policy development and for the First Minister to meet the STUC biannually to discuss current issues.
Carol Mochan.
Thank you. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer? Trade unions have campaigned for the immediate implementation of safe staffing legislation in the NHS. They have fought against funding cuts to the Fire and Rescue Service, and they have fought to rid our schools of violence. But on each of these points, the Government has let them down. If the Cabinet Secretary truly values the contribution of trade unions and considers fair work to be a key principle of a wellbeing economy, why are the Government overseeing a falling employment rate, a widening gender pay gap, declining employee voice and the reduction in secure contracts?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would challenge that. Actually, in all elements that Carol Mochan referenced, there's progress being made on all. And, for instance, on the gender pay gap, we've seen the gender pay gap reduce in Scotland, contrary to what Carol Mochan has set out, particularly for full-time workers, but also compared to the rest of the UK, a much lower gender pay gap. And that is because of the good work that has been done in collaboration with the trade union movement to see the fair work conditionality applied to ensure that we can bring up the standards of working conditions across both the public and private sectors, and we'll continue to collaborate in that manner going forward.
And supplementary, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I declare an interest as a member of Unison. With draconian legislation like the anti-strike bill passed through the UK Parliament, it's clear that protecting workers' rights is more important than ever. This is another appalling piece of legislation from Westminster that will harm and not improve industrial relations. Can I ask what steps are the Scottish Government taking to stop these Westminster attacks on Scottish workers and to help deliver fair work in a wellbeing economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, President Officer, and I agree with Kevin Stewart. The Scottish Government views this legislation as being unnecessary and expects it will be completely ineffective. In fact, as Kevin Stewart says, counterproductive. I and my colleagues have written to UK ministers expressing our strong opposition to the introduction of minimum service levels and associated codes of practice. We will continue to do all we can to resist this piece of anti-worker, anti-trade union legislation. However, the attack on workers' rights underlines exactly why the devolution at the very minimum of employment law is imperative. This viewpoint is championed by the STUC and other organisations. I think the Scottish Labour Party is on side with this. I don't think the UK Labour Party is, but underlines that short of getting employment law devolved, we need independence to make sure we have an employment system that really meets the needs of workers and employers.
Question number three, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it is planning any new infrastructure investments in the next financial year in connection with city and regional growth deals.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We are investing £1.9 billion in the city and region growth deals, which are part of an ongoing programme of investment across Scotland. A significant milestone in 2024-25 will be the Argyll and Bute and Falkirk deals moving into delivery in the next financial year, meaning all 12 deals will be in delivery. As of quarter two, 23-24, deals in delivery have drawn from £991.71 million of the total investment by Scottish and UK governments, which has been used to increase growth across Scotland.
Sue Webber.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. The Scottish Government has committed £300 million in the Edinburgh and South East Scotland region deal. However, economic development has stagnated as communities remain isolated due to poor transport links. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that investment in projects like Winchborough Station will be critical to economic growth in the region?
Cabinet Secretary.
So obviously it's for local deal partners to take forward their priorities and to take forward business cases in respect of drawing down on the funds coming forward. And I appreciate the need for good public transport connectivity, and we'll continue to work with local partners on the areas that Sue Webber has set out to take forward those projects as quickly as possible.
A supplementary, Claire Baker.
Thank you. In regard to the UK Government's proposals for investment zones, what consideration has the Scottish Government given to proposing Fife Energy Park as a cluster area? This would level the playing field so it can compete for work in the renewable sector alongside Green Freeports. As the Cabinet Secretary knows, it is not in the Forthport Green Freeport area, and this risks leaving it at a disadvantage when it's trying to expand its business and increase local employment opportunities.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Claire Baker for that question. Obviously, we're working with colleagues in regional economic partnerships on both city and regional growth deals and investment zones, on innovation zones and others, on ensuring that the needs and the desires of those local communities are at the forefront of the decisions that are taken on what incentives come through those particular processes. And I'd happy to take any further representation that either she or other local representatives would have in the idea that she has set out.
Question number four, Rosa Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with its enterprise agencies regarding how to support innovation by small businesses, including in relation to the use of alternative fuels such as hydro-treated vegetable oil.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
The Scottish Government and its enterprise agencies are committed to working with our small businesses to support them to innovate and adopt new technologies and processes to increase their resilience and capacity for growth. And Scotland's enterprise agencies have co-designed, co-invested and delivered the Advanced Manufacturing Challenge and Low Carbon Manufacturing Challenge funds, supporting Scotland's manufacturing SMEs in sustainable innovation. So we envision using bioenergy only where the finite supply of sustainable bioresources can best achieve net zero, and officials are engaging with enterprise agencies on a bioenergy policy statement, which will be published in due course.
Rhoda Grant.
HVO can be sustainably sourced and stocked in Scotland, and using it allows companies such as Highland Fuels to provide renewable and sustainable replacements for fossil fuels for businesses and homes that are off gas grid and poorly insulated in the Highlands and Islands. Can I ask, as part of that statement, what steps the government and its enterprise agencies are taking to widen its availability by local production and distribution?
Minister.
Well, I'd be happy, given it's an important issue that the member raises, to learn more about Highland Fuels' concerns and asks in terms of this overall policy. And as I said, a policy statement has been developed on bioenergy. So if there's any specific elements they feel should be in that statement, I'd be grateful to hear from them directly. Now, biofuels such as bio-LPG or hydro-treated vegetable oil, known as HVO, may be able to provide a low-carbon solution to heating off-gas grid homes and indeed businesses, but it is the case that further evidence is required regarding the sustainability and costs of these fuels. So it is important we do speak to local companies that are interested in taking this forward, like Highland Fuels, and I'd be grateful to hear from them directly.
Question number 5, Jamie Halcrow-Johnson, who is joining us remotely. Mr Halcrow-Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government how it will support small businesses over the coming months.
Minister Richard Lochhead.
Businesses in Scotland can access advice, guidance and financial support from a wide range of organisations across the public sector, most of which is available to any business anywhere in Scotland and whatever stage of growth it's at. We are delivering a competitive non-domestic rates package worth an estimated £749 million this year, and our small business bonus scheme relief ensures that around half of properties in the retail, hospitality and leisure sectors in the country will pay no rates. Of course, decisions on non-domestic rates for the 24-25 year will be announced in the context of the Scottish Budget.
Jamie Halcrow-Johnson.
As the Minister will be aware, businesses across the Highlands and Islands already face additional challenges and costs to businesses in other parts of Scotland. But as raised by my colleague Jeremy Balfour earlier, as well as new burdens placed on the sector, short-term LETS licensing and the calamitous deposit return scheme being just two, Scottish ministers still refuse to introduce a 75% rates relief for Scottish hospitality and tourism that the UK government provides south of the border, and which the Scottish government has been given the funding to deliver. So can I ask the minister, will this SNP Green Coalition finally listen to businesses in my region, to the Scottish Conservatives, and even to those from their own benches who back the move, and use the funding they've been provided by the UK government to give a much needed boost to Scottish hospitality and tourism?
Minister.
I thank the member for the question. Of course, it gives me an opportunity to remind him that I speak to hospitality businesses regularly, the length and breadth of Scotland, including the Highlands and Islands, and my own constituency, who quote a number of issues that are affecting their bottom line at the moment, and they are facing a very tough trading environment and costs. So they tell me, for instance, that the biggest issue affecting them is the rocketing energy costs. Yep. Which of course is an issue reserved to the UK government. Shortage of labour, particularly in the Highlands and Islands, as a result of Brexit, which of course is an issue reserved to the UK government. The impact of inflation on goods and services, again an issue which the UK government has influence over and has made some serious mistakes over as well. And of course the campaign to reduce VAT for tourism, which would bring a big boost to the businesses in the Highlands and Islands. But of course the Scottish government does have responsibility over a number of important issues, as the member highlights. And in the forthcoming budget, we will consider those, of course, and we have to wait what that says. But he says money provided by the UK government. Therefore, he's clearly been asleep for the last couple of weeks, because the autumn statement delivered paltry consequentials for this government, which means we face a very difficult situation with the Scottish budget. And that's another example of the UK government
Thank
let
you,
down
Minister.
The hospitality
Thank
sector.
You. I need to
but
take,
we'll do
I need
we
to
can
take
to
supplementaries. I have, in fact, received two supplementaries, and we have some time, so I'll be able to take both. First supplementary, Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of the biggest challenges small businesses face is being paid on time. It absorbs significant amounts of founders' time, as well as the obvious cash flow challenges late payments create. Often, unfortunately, larger businesses will extend payment terms to effectively use their supply chain as a source of free working capital. My understanding is that legislation in this area is devolved rather than reserved. So can I ask the Minister to confirm his understanding of devolved competence in this area, and whether the Scottish Government has given any thought to legislating to require businesses to pay their suppliers on time?
Minister.
I thank Ivan McKee for raising an important issue for Scotland's small businesses and all businesses. And I do want to confirm that this is within the devolved competence. And, of course, I agree with Ivan McKee that small businesses in particular should be paid for their services or products on time. That's one reason why we recently updated our public procurement prompt payment guidance. And, of course, as one of the actions set out in the New Deal for Business Implementation Plan, the government will be working with small businesses to identify proactive regulations to support them in this and other regards. So prompt payment will form part of these discussions.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you. Brexit and the resultant economic turmoil have, of course, made life hard for businesses in Scotland. Given the limited financial levers available to Scotland, which the Minister has mentioned, can he outline the impact of the UK's recent disappointing autumn statement on the government's scope to respond to the real challenges facing small businesses?
Minister.
Yes, Alistair Allen again raises the pretty devastating impact of UK policy on many of Scotland's businesses, including in his own constituency. And in my previous answer, I quoted that energy, VAT, the impact of Brexit on labour shortages and inflation, and indeed a host of other issues, that largely is a responsibility, of course, of UK government policy over the last few years in particular. That's had a big impact on the bottom line of many businesses in Scotland. And, of course, the autumn statement, therefore, was the most recent disappointment, where the paltry consequentials coming to this government limits our ability to try and repair some of that damage for Scotland's businesses.
I call question number 6, Neil Bibby, who's joining us remotely. Mr Bibby.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met the GMB trade union to discuss the future of Ferguson Marine Yard.
Cabinet Secretary.
I last met GMB officials to exclusively discuss Ferguson's on the 10th of November.
Your baby.
I thank Mr Gray for that answer. Both the GMB and I are keen to understand what the Scottish Government is going to do to secure a future pipeline of work for the yard. On that, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the BEE Systems MOD work is a vote of confidence in the yard's workforce? And does he also acknowledge the yard has a positive track record on delivering smaller, simpler and standardised ferries under budget and under time? And does he believe that that puts the yard in a strong place to deliver the small vessel replacement programme?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Neil Bibby for his question and continued interest alongside others, including Stuart McMillan, on the future of the yard. And I know that there's been much collaboration locally on this. I continue to be committed to securing a sustainable future, doing everything that the government possibly can do to sustain a sustainable future for the shipyard. Decisions on which vessel opportunities to pursue are for Ferguson Marine Management and Board of Directors. We know that the shipyard is actively pursuing many streams of future work and will continue to support them in any way we can to secure new contracts and a sustainable future. On the small vessels, whether it's on direct award or otherwise, it would be inappropriate for me to comment directly, except to say Mr Bibby has set out the heritage that Ferguson's have, the outstanding workforce that there is there, and that direct awards are only legal in strictly limited circumstances under public procurement rules.
Supplementary, Willie Rennie.
The Cabinet Secretary met the GMB. Did he discuss the possible privatisation of the yard and whether this is a factor in any future direct award of ferries directly to Ferguson's?
Cabinet Secretary.
We have previously discussed the government's strategy to return Ferguson's to the private sector at a time that it is right. And we continue to engage both with the trade unions that are involved there, GMB, but also with the management and the board at Ferguson's around the future. And indeed, as has been raised by Mr Rennie, but also Mr Bibby, around the potential for future work. And we'll continue to support them in the business plans that need to come forward in order to support some of our elements of support that can come forward through that.
And supplementary, Katie Clark.
It was reported that plans to procure the 7 small vessels have been delayed for nearly 2 years. Does the Minister accept that islanders cannot wait that long? And what is being done to ensure that those vessels are built on the Clyde?
Cabinet Secretary.
I've already set out in terms of my answers to both Mr Bibby, Mr Rennie, in terms of the decision-making process that has to be gone through in terms of where the small vessel replacement programme can be cited. The decisions around when that procurement takes place are for ministerial colleagues, and it's right that that is respected. But obviously we want to make sure that whether it's the ships that are being built in Ferguson's or elsewhere, that we see a resilient ferry fleet for Scotland's island communities. As an islander myself, I understand the importance of that, and for it to be done as quickly as is possible.
Question number 7, Oliver Mundell. Mr Mundell is joining us remotely. Mr Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will consider carrying out an analysis of the potential impact of renewable energy and the associated infrastructure on farmland and food production in Dumfriesshire.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Where the new proposal for renewable energy development is brought forward, National Planning Framework 4, Policy 5, Soils, is clear that proposals on prime agricultural land or land of lesser quality that is culturally or locally important for primary use, as identified by the local development plan, will only be supported in limited circumstances. All applications are considered on a case-by-case basis, and a careful balance must be struck between potential impacts and benefits.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Minister for that answer. On top of wind farm applications, solar farm applications and power lines, constituents in my Dumfriesshire constituency are now seeing a deluge of applications for battery storage, many of which appear to be on good agricultural ground and don't seem to be subject to the same level of scrutiny. Is this something the Minister will commit to look into and review further?
Gillian Martin, Minister.
There is a great deal of scrutiny of applications of the type that Mr Mundell outlines. We do need to rapidly accelerate our deployment of renewables and electricity infrastructure in order to support decarbonisation of the GB grid by 2035, and significant investment in our grid infrastructure is required to include ensure that clean, low-cost, renewable electricity can flow to where it's needed. This is an imperative national mission. It's a mission for the UK government as well as the Scottish government. Indeed, it's a mission for all governments across Europe that we need sustainable, secure, green energy. And the infrastructure that's required needs to be, the plannings for that need to be scrutinised, and the potential impacts on community, nature and other receptors, including cumulative impacts, are very important considerations in that decision-making process.
And question number 8, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what action it has taken to support the recommendations of the Short Life Working Group on economic and social opportunities for Gaelic.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government welcomes the report of the Short Life Working Group on economic and social opportunities for Gaelic and has set up an internal Scottish Government steering group to consider the wide-ranging recommendations. The Scottish Government expects to issue a response to the group in the early months of 2024.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. The recent publication of the Scottish Languages Bill was very welcome. So can the Cabinet Secretary indicate which of the report's recommendations may intersect with the provisions in the new bill? For example, the potential for the creation of Gaelic economic zones or additional support for entrepreneurs in designated areas of linguistic significance.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I thank Dr Allen for his question. There is a welcome overlap between the Gaelic Economy Report and the recently introduced Scottish Languages Bill, and this is something that Dr Allen and I and Arthur Cormack explored in the recent meeting that we held on this subject. And as Dr Allen is aware, the Gaelic Economy Report contains a wide range of recommendations impacting on a number of areas, including population, infrastructure, public sector, Gaelic plans, communities and education. And the report also lists key sectors that are important for the social and economic progress of Gaelic. The provisions of the bill, including the drafting of a Gaelic strategy and Gaelic standards, the designation of areas of a linguistic significance and improved Gaelic language plans, all have the potential to cover and make progress with the recommendations and key sectors identified in the Gaelic Economy Report and the basis from which Kate Forbes instituted the review in the first place.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on wellbeing, economy, fair work and energy. I will allow a very brief pause before we move on to the next portfolio questions to allow front bench teams to change position should they wish. Thank you.
Thank you. The next portfolio is finance and parliamentary business. Again, if a member wishes to ask a supplementary, request to ask a supplementary, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS, if online, during the relevant question. I call question number one, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to propose the scheduling of time for a ministerial statement on the duelling of the A9.
Minister George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Mr Mountain for the question. The Scottish Government remains firmly committed to completing the duelling of the A9 between Perth and Inverness. Work to determine the most suitable procurement options for the remaining sections of the A9 duelling is now well advanced, and procurement of the Tomatin to Moy project is continuing. We expect to update the Parliament on a renewed programme in the coming days.
Edward Mountain.
Well, now, I've got to push on that, because this government's got form on this. In 2007, they promised to duel the A9 by 2025. In 2023, they were forced to admit that they wouldn't do that. In 2023, the minister promised a statement to this parliament with a backstop of autumn to deliver what she'd found out on the A9 and what was going to happen. She's clearly broken that. Surely this government would be much better off to be honest and come to this chamber without being forced to tell us when we're going to find out when they will deliver the promises that they've so far failed to keep.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll just stick with the actual detail here itself. And as the Minister for Parliamentary Business, I can explain the process when the statement is going forward. As the member knows, proposals for business in Parliament are subject to consideration by the Parliamentary Bureau and in turn approved by Parliament. The Scottish Government remains firmly committed to completing the duelling of the A9 between Perth and Inverness, and we expect to update Parliament on a renewed programme in the coming days.
I've received a request from two members for supplementaries. I will take both. I will take firstly Willie Rennie.
Does the Minister not understand the irritation that's felt throughout the Highlands and, in fact, the whole of Scotland by the prevarication from the Government? And the Minister can't give us vague answers. Is he proposing a statement before Christmas or is he not?
Minister.
I really don't think I could be any clearer, Presiding Officer, than saying in the coming days there will be details about the statement. That's pretty obvious for everyone to take from that.
And supplementary, Fergus Ewing.
When the Transport Minister does make her A9 statement, it must include putting all 8 remaining single carriageway sections into procurement. And if it's believed private finance is to be used, does the Scottish Government understand that it's also essential that the Inverness to Nairn and Nairn bypass section of the A96 should also be placed into procurement with it at the same time and all within the next 3 months?
Minister.
I thank Mr Ewing for the question, and as the Minister for Parliamentary Business, I cannot comment. However, I will ask the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, Net Zero and Just Transition to write to Mr Ewing on this issue.
Question number two, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on any impact on communities, including in the North East, of conditionality in public sector procurement.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank the Member for her question. We use conditionality and other carefully crafted approaches as part of our procurement policies and processes to drive social, economic and environmental outcomes, publishing evidence of impact annually. The £14.5 billion of procurement spending covering financial year 2020-2021 supported around £12.5 billion of economic activity, around 120,000 full-time equivalent jobs, and contributed around £6.9 billion to Scottish GDP benefiting communities across Scotland.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for that response and the detail contained therein. The Scottish Government rightly expects companies that are awarded public contracts to maintain high standards of business and professional conduct, including following international law and taking environmental protections and human rights seriously. Can the Minister outline how the Scottish Government is implementing these principles and values with respect to any business dealings with companies and others involved in illegal settlements in the occupied Palestinian territories?
Minister.
Thank the Member for her question. The Scottish Government strongly discourages trade and investment from illegal settlements anywhere in the world, and it's absolutely right that the Scottish Government should expect companies that are awarded public contracts to maintain the highest standards of business and professional conduct.
The Scottish Government has taken a number of steps following the publication in 2020 of the Office of the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights database of companies active in listed activity in the occupied Palestinian territories. We wrote to public bodies in Scotland and asked that they consider the database as part of their human rights due diligence process. We also contacted companies who are listed on the database and have a relationship with the Scottish public body to ask what they are doing to cease the activities that led to their inclusion. And as the First Minister confirmed to Parliament in November, we are currently considering next steps following the publication of the revised database in June 2023.
Question number three, Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recommendations outlined in the STUC's report, Raising Taxes to Deliver for Scotland.
Minister Tom Arthur.
We are very grateful for the contribution made by the work published by the Scottish Trade Unions Congress. We will, of course, reflect carefully on their proposals and those brought forward by other organisations. Our tax policy and spending plans for 2024-25 will be announced at the Budget on 19 December. Our Budget will deliver against our three central missions of equality, opportunity and community.
Katie Clark.
In November 2022, I asked whether there was any work going on in the Scottish Government to look at a land value tax and was told that there was not. Since then, has any work been carried out over the last year to consider the feasibility of any version of a land value tax or indeed any form of land-based taxation to raise additional revenue, given these forms of taxation are fully devolved?
Minister.
I would remind the member that we are, per our existing commitments, engaged in a joint working group with COSLA to look at sources of funding for local government, including reform of the council tax. As part of that process, we are open to considering a wide range of measures, and indeed, from the work that has been undertaken to date, we have brought forward regulations, for example, on council tax and the treatment of second homes. We are committed to progressing this work further in the new year, and on any specific proposals that members may have, I'm more than happy to engage with them directly.
I have received requests for three supplementaries and I will be able to take all three. I call firstly Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Not a single Labour MSP saw enough merit in the STUC's recommendations to sign Monica Lennon's motion in support of them, despite many Labour MSPs being funded by trade unions. Does the Minister agree that this reflects how unrealistic these proposals are, given they appear to take no account whatsoever of the impact on taxpayer behaviour and revenue that would accrue? Or is it because of UK Labour policy not to, and I quote, turn on the spending taps if they come to office?
Minister, please respond in terms of the matters within your jurisdiction. Thank you.
Certainly, Presiding Officer. As I said in my original answer, we are very grateful to all organisations, including the STUC, who have submitted proposals, and indeed the range of business organisations and other think tanks who have brought forward proposals for consideration. The reality, however, is that we are limited in what measures we can take forward under the existing devolution settlement. For example, for this Parliament to legislate for new national taxes requires the agreement of the UK Government as per ATB, Section 80B of the Scotland Act. What I would note is that while there are members in the Labour group in this place who advocate new forms of taxation, that is in sharp contradiction to the proposals or lack of proposals put forward by the UK Labour Party, and indeed with the Shadow Chancellor, Rachel Reeves, being very clear in our opposition to, for example, wealth taxes. So I, to be honest, I'm not quite sure where the Labour Party stand. I think there is division within their group in this place, and I certainly think there's division between their group and their Westminster Parliamentary group.
Supplementary, Liz Smith.
Thank you. Of course, the CBI in Scotland takes a very different view on tax from the STUC, asking the Scottish Government to abandon any policies that are uncompetitive when it comes to tax. So I wonder if that's going to be addressed in the forthcoming budget.
Minister.
As Liz Smith will be aware, we assess all tax proposals against our framework for tax. And indeed, we are committed to updating our tax strategy at the time of the MTFS in the spring. So we take into account a range of factors, which includes, yes, supporting public finances, particularly important given the horrendous settlement we are receiving as a consequence of the autumn statement, but also ensuring that we can support a competitive and dynamic economy in Scotland.
And supplementary, Kate Forbes.
Minister accept that the very reason we're having these conversations about tax is because the UK government has completely slashed the consequential funding that is coming to Scotland, yeah, as per the OBR evidence of the Finance Committee yesterday, which suggested that £19 billion is being cut in real terms to English departments, which results in far less consequential funding to Scotland in the first place?
Minister.
I think Kate Forbes sets out the evidence very clearly. The further point I would want to add to that I think is very important is the lack, almost now, the complete absence of headroom that the Chancellor has left himself, and indeed the risk that these horrendous cuts that we are facing may not be the end of it, but only the start of it. The UK Government has shown a reckless approach to the economy, whether it be a decision to pursue the hardest of hard Brexits or indeed the calamitous mini-budget under Liz Truss, which the Conservative Party in this place gave their full-throated support to. Again, this underlines the reason why the people of Scotland would be far better served if this Parliament had the full powers of an independent nation.
Question number 4, Mercedes Viaba.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to develop a wealth tax for Scotland.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Any approach to wealth taxes must consider the limits of tax powers currently devolved to the Scottish Parliament or seek agreement between the Scottish and UK Parliaments to devolve further tax powers to create a new tax. We believe that powers should be devolved to this Parliament so that the taxation of wealth can be redesigned to work fairly and effectively in a modern Scotland-specific context. We consider all tax proposals in line with our framework for tax, as well as our commitment to progressivity and fairness to ensure those with the broadest shoulders contribute the most.
Mercedes Viaba.
In September, the First Minister said he would consider a wealth tax, but his government has already had 16 years in power and wealth remains concentrated in the hands of a few. So can the Minister confirm what discussions the Scottish Government has had with the SDUC about their wealth tax proposals and when the First Minister's consideration will turn into real action on a wealth tax?
Before I call the Minister to respond, can we not have conversations across front benches, please? It's disrespectful to the person who is asking the question. Minister, please respond.
Well, of course, we are committed in terms of the proposals which the STUC have set forward to considering them all carefully. The specific STUC proposal, as I understand it, is for a local wealth tax, something that would be locally administered and at the discretion of local authorities. Now, we have, per our commitments to local government, embarked on a programme of work for fiscal empowerment. I made reference to the regulations that have been brought forward regarding the council tax treatment of second homes. We also have the local visitor levy bill progressing through Parliament. But that bill is to create a discretionary power, and any further powers for local government would, by their nature, have to be discretionary, recognising our commitments in that area. As regards a national wealth tax, which I think is perhaps what the member and others would like to see, for that to take place, it would require the agreement of the UK Government and the UK Parliament. Now, I don't want to be presumptuous, but I don't think that is something the Conservatives subscribe to. But I know it's something that the Labour Party doesn't subscribe to, because Rachel Reeves has said as much.
And supplementary, Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The biggest part of wealth, of course, is held in property assets, and everyone recognises that council tax, of course, is hugely regressive. Given its commitment to progressive taxation, can I ask what work the Scottish Government has done to evaluate what percentage of property value a proportionate property tax would need to be set at to be revenue neutral, and what percentage of current council taxpayers would pay less than they currently do as a consequence?
Minister.
Well, I thank the member for his question. I'm not in a position to provide specific details of what these hypothetical costings would entail. However, we are committed, as I mentioned in my earlier answers, to working constructively with COSLA through the joint working group to look at options for reform of the council tax. And indeed, I am more than happy to engage with any member in this chamber who wants to bring forward constructive proposals that we can work together on in partnership with local government to seek to deliver.
Question number 5, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in relation to setting its budget and fiscal policy for 24-25, whether it has undertaken any quantifiable financial analysis of the relative performance of European countries comparable in size to Scotland.
Deputy First Minister.
The first paper in our Building a New Scotland series published last year compared the UK's performance across a range of economic and social indicators with that of countries in Europe comparable to Scotland. It found these countries are wealthier, with GDP per capita in every comparator country being higher. They are fairer, as income inequality and poverty rates are lower. And finally, the comparator countries have higher productivity. As the series is setting out, with the powers of independence, we would have all the levers we need to create a more prosperous and fairer Scotland.
Bill Kidd.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Destructive Brexit agendas mean Scotland is missing out on so many opportunities, such as the EU's Next Gen EU Economic Recovery Programme. Can the Cabinet Secretary say what benefits comparative-sized EU countries are receiving from this transformative European stimulus package and what it could mean for an independent Scotland in the EU?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, certainly Bill Kidd has set out one of a number of consequences of Brexit. The centrepiece of Next Generation EU is the Recovery and Resilience Facility, an instrument that offers grants and loans to support reforms and investments in the EU member states for a total of €723.8 billion in current prices. An independent Scotland in the EU would, of course, benefit enormously from such an initiative. To offer a comparison to a similarly sized neighbour, the Republic of Ireland is set to receive over €900 million in recovery and resilience facility grants.
Question number six, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its latest engagement has been with the UK Government regarding the funding available to support households with the cost of living during the Christmas season.
Deputy First Minister.
As outlined to Parliament on the 22nd of November, I wrote to the Chancellor ahead of the autumn statement setting out the Scottish Government's priorities for action. I also spoke to the new Chief Secretary to the Treasury on the 22nd of November and again emphasised the need for investment in public services, net zero, and to support people with cost of living. This followed a number of letters ministers have sent to the UK Government over the past few months, calling on them to do more for households that are struggling financially, including the introduction of an essentials guarantee to ensure that benefits are sufficient to allow people to afford food and fuel. It's very disappointing the UK Government continues to fail to provide the funding that devolved governments need, and this increases the challenges for our budget next year and also the difficulties facing households right across the country.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. Recent financial research undertaken by PwC indicates Christmas spending in the UK will drop by 11% this year compared to 2022, an average of around £440 per consumer. And 18% of people in Scotland anticipate spending less due to having less money, the damaging cost of living, and having less confidence in their future finances. The measures in the recent autumn statement won't touch the sides of most households who've seen their monthly costs go through the roof. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that even with promotional events such as Black Friday, Christmas will be out of reach for many households this year, and that the UK Government must change course from wreaking economic havoc to delivering fiscal policy that will make a tangible difference to people living in Scotland?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, Audrey Nicholl is absolutely right that the continuing cost of living crisis will have a damaging impact on many people this Christmas, and we are doing all that we can with the resources available to us. But Scotland is being badly let down by the economic mismanagement and misguided priorities of the UK government. Their autumn statement prioritised a tax cut over public spending and failed to provide support for people with the cost of living or the funding that our public services need. The UK Government's decision to starve public services in England hits our budget in Scotland, and all the devolved governments are feeling the impact. I called on the Chancellor to prioritise public services and support people with the cost of living in the autumn statement, but instead we got an austerity budget. However, it's not too late to change course, and I would urge him to do so.
Question number seven, Ash Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to allocate funding to local authorities in its upcoming budget to facilitate the cancellation of any school meal debt and expand universal free school meal provision to those age groups that are not currently entitled.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. Thank the member for the question, which is really important because we know that school meal debt can have a significant impact on the mental well-being of families and where any family is experiencing difficulties. In the first instance, I would urge, we'd expect local authorities to use the powers available to them and to provide any necessary support. While school meal debt specifically is a matter for local authorities, the Scottish Government is determined to do everything we can to support people through the cost of living crisis, and we will consider all options available to us to ensure families do not find themselves punished for struggling through tough financial times.
Ash Regan.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The families of 30,000 children across Scotland are in debt over the cost of school meals. And it might possibly be something to do with the income thresholds. The school meal eligibility, they've barely risen in the last 20 years. In 2002, low-income working families with an income of less than £13,230 were eligible. Today, that income threshold has risen to just under £19,000. However, if that had been adjusted for inflation, the income threshold from 2 decades ago would now be the equivalent of just under £28,000. So will the Scottish Government consider maximising eligibility for free school meals for low-income working families to reduce that financial hardship that the Minister has spoken of and to help end school meal debt and help tackle the cost of living crisis?
Minister.
Thank you, Member, for our supplementary question. It's important that children and young people are able to have access to healthy and nutritious meals as part of their learning. The Scottish Government recognises this, which is why Scotland has the most comprehensive free school meal offer in the UK, serving families who take up the offer of an average of £400 per eligible child per year. We are committed to expanding this further going forward, and as I said in my initial response, the Scottish Government is looking at all options to support families struggling through this cost of living crisis.
Question number 8, Daniel Johnson.
I'd remind the Chamber of my register of interest to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its progress in implementing the recommendations made by the New Deal for Business Group on reforming non-domestic rates.
Minister Tom Arthur.
We have already made progress and extended the deadline for lodging non-domestic rates proposals, providing businesses with an extra month to submit their 2023 revaluation proposals. The New Deal for Business Group implementation plan, published on 19 October of this year, details how all the recommendations, including from the consultative subgroup on non-domestic rates, will be taken forward over the next 18 months. The subgroup continues to meet regularly and has established a number of short-life task teams to report back to the subgroup.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Minister for that answer. And while the fiscal circumstances may mean that the Government has had to rule out passing on the 75% rate reduction in general, in specific, tourism and hospitality face invidious circumstances of increasing costs in terms of utility bills and wages at a time when transaction volumes are down. So can I ask, has the Scottish Government considered making specific measures and extensions for that sector in particular? And has it carried out any modelling on the impact of holding business rates level and indeed what the cost will be from business failures if business rates are held at their current level?
Minister.
As the member will appreciate, the budget will be published next week, so I'm limited in what I can say. What I will say is I'm extremely grateful to those operating right across various sectors, but including in hospitality and in tourism, for their constructive engagement as part of the pre-budget engagement process, and indeed for their valuable contribution towards the work of the non-domestic rates subgroup. I am committed to continuing to working with business on the work of the subgroup as we take that forward into the new year, to look at what meaningful and constructive changes that we can make to the non-domestic rate system to ensure that it supports investment and creates opportunities for all businesses in Scotland.
And supplementary from Murdo Fraser, who's joining us online. Mr Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm sorry that Daniel Johnson and the Labour Party seem to have given up the fight on 75% rates relief for retail, hospitality and leisure. I've just seen within the last few minutes the top asks from the Scottish Chambers of Commerce for the coming budget. Number one is to pass on that 75% rates relief. Number two is no widening of the income tax differential between Scotland and the rest of the UK. Is the Scottish Government listening?
Minister.
Well, I'm very grateful to the Chambers of Commerce for their engagement throughout this process. on our work with the subgroup on non-domestic rates, and particularly to the work of Liz Cameron as the business lead within this group. I'm very grateful for all of these submissions that have been made and the ideas put forward. We will set out our policies across all areas of taxation and spend at the budget next week. But what is inescapable is we are facing the most challenging budget situation since devolution, and that follows directly from the decisions of Murdo Fraser's colleagues in the UK Government at the autumn statement, where we are seeing a paltry £10.8 million of consequentials coming for the health service. Is that really the position of the Conservatives in this group? Is that the position of Conservatives here? Is that the position of the Scottish Conservative health spokesman? That the uplift for the health service next year should be £10.8 million out of a budget of £19 billion. If it is, then it is an utterly shameful position.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on finance and parliamentary business. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change position should they so wish. Thank you.